All right. Hello and welcome, everyone. Before we get into today's video, we have a sponsor for today's video, and that sponsor is The Ridge. As you probably know from our previous spots, they make high-quality wallets using metal and elastic, and with Father's Day on the way, they make the perfect gift for the father or father figure in your life. I've used and loved them for years, and I'm happy to say I'll be switching into one of the new premium designs between Damascus Steel and Forged Ember. And if you'd like to purchase one as a gift, even if that gift is to yourself, you can head over to theridge.com/brozyme and use code brozyme at checkout to get 10% off and help support the channel. Thanks so much to The Ridge for sponsoring us yet again, and let's get into the video. Alright, hello everyone, and welcome to the DevStream 155 Breakdown. So, sorry this is coming a little bit later and kind of in the older style that we've done before, but I had some computer troubles that made this a little bit harder to get out, involving one of my PCs kind of not being available right now. So, we are here with the DevStream 155 Breakdown, and this is a pretty information-packed DevStream, but also like has a lot of weird things to talk about. So we're going to kind of go to a lot of places. And the first weird place that we're going to go is the new fan merch policy that DE put out. So I have the whole policy itself here, barring some examples that they give on the actual page for the fan merch policy. But this is really, really interesting and I think has some immediate cool applications that might be able to come to the community at large. I know this is maybe going to be a little, you know, narrow in terms of who this applies to because it is for fans creating merch. But it's pretty well outlined here that people can create 3D models of Warframes and such and then sell those on like Etsy and stuff. And I know that there are already people that are into this side stuff here of getting into 3D printing that are in the Tenogen space where they're making, you know, full Warframe high quality models of their Tenogen stuff. And that's how they make the Tenogen, of course, is to have these very high quality 3D models. And taking that and 3D printing that Tenogen stuff and then selling that on Etsy as like high quality figures and stuff sounds really, really cool to me. And it's really awesome that DE put out a really, really lenient policy that allows people that are working on Tenogen and stuff and are already making some money from doing Warframe stuff to expand that into people like, you know, possibly getting like real 3D figures in real life that they can, you know, paint with like a Warhammer paints and stuff like that, and kind of get their own custom Warframes, you know, as like a nice statue that you can have around as decoration and stuff. That was just like the immediate thing that my mind went to, and with the examples that they give in their policy even. And I think that would be really, really cool. So knowing that there are some people in the Tenogen space that are already dabbling in 3D printing and stuff, if you've got like a favorite Tenogen creator or something like that, I think it's probably worth asking them if they're planning to get onto the like 3D printing train. And I know a lot of them have Twitters and stuff where they're fairly active. So it might be an interesting thing to look into if you've always wanted your favorite Tenogen skin as like a model that you can just have for real. So that stuff's really interesting. I think that the fan merch policy is great and it's something that was completely unexpected and I don't know who is asking for it, but it's awesome. So cool. Moving on, we have some stuff to talk about just with generally the Sisters of Parvos, which we know is an update that is coming. It is going to be sometime in June. No specifics, but I think we can probably assume late June. Or at least after the Dog Days event, which is going to be coming back on June 7th. And then that we have another detail with that, but we'll get to that in a moment. So, the Sisters of Parvos, that is going to contain Yureli, the new Warframe, which we have details on from today. The Sisters of Parvos themselves, which are the Corpus Liches, for those not aware. Some additional Voidstorm rewards, which we are going to get into a little bit more when we talk about Railjack additions. And then we have some Kuba Lich improvements that really weren't gone into. Hopefully those improvements circle very much around murmurs and stuff, as that is a very long part of the Kuba Lich process. And we're going to be talking about some additions to the Kuba Lich process. And also, we now know that we are going to be going to the Granum Voids to start a Kuba, to start a Corpus Lich, the Sisters of Parvos. And that is going to work in much the same way as the Kuba Liches are now, but it'll actually be more consistent in our ability to start it. So anytime you use the high-level Granum coins, it's going to give you a character to take down, and you'll be able to see their weapon and all the good information that we get from the current Kuva Liches to try and make sure that you're getting that weapon that you're looking for. So that's really nice. I think the Granum Void is a really good system. That it's nice that it's getting a little bit more, but I really wish that they would go back to the Granum Void and, you know, reevaluate the rewards that are coming from it to kind of make it more long-term just by itself without the need to attach Corpus Liches to it. And I think the Granum Void, with it being so much of a like one-time side activity to get Protea up until now is really probably going to make it pretty hard for newer players to know that this is how you get Corpus Liches anyway. Regardless of that, we also know that for Murmurs, for the Sisters of Parvos, we're going to be taking down their hounds instead of their like little lieutenant guys and stuff like we would for the Kuva Liches. And they are going to be less hounds that you're going to need to kill, and you're going to get more Murmurs for them. So there's fewer enemies that you're going to get the actual Murmur progress on. And the hounds are, of course, going to be tougher, and they look like they have massive shields, and there was some mention of magnetic being an important damage type against them and stuff like that. And the other addition to this is that all liches will now retreat to Railjack whenever you figure out all of their different, like, lich glyphs. So once you have the code to kill them, they all retreat to Railjack, and you have to go do Railjack to kill them. That is maybe good, depending on what the mission to actually go and kill your liches entails. Because if it's like this big, long, protracted mission that has like a bunch of mobile defenses and stuff and just adds a ton of time to the end of a lich, that probably is not great, because it's also going to require you to, you know, be invested in Railjack and have your Railjack up to speed with the level that we get from our Kuva missions. And of course, what we're expecting from the Sisters of Parvos missions, they are much higher level missions than normal. And I would assume that these missions are going to be those higher level Railjack missions. And it's going to be pretty tough to convince someone that they need to go do all this Railjack stuff to also to get access to their Kuva Lich things, which are much more accessible now and earlier on in the game at current. So we'll see how it turns out. If they shorten the Murmur grind by a good chunk, but then you do Railjack at the end, I think it'll be like a nice middle ground. And I know people want shorter Murmurs just in general, because that's certainly the most boring part of Kuva Liches right now, because it's an entirely, you know, separate island of things to do, because it's not really connected to anything else in the game. So there's that. And then beyond that, just Railjack stuff in general, we know what rank 10 command is now, and unfortunately it is elite crewmates. So elite crewmates will unlock at rank 10, and they will have traits, and this bonus will be associated with whatever their best skill is. So like if they're good at gunning, they'll get like 50% more damage with Vidar weapons specifically, and then, you know, they'll get like heal allies whenever they kill stuff and things of that nature. Overall, for rank 10 command, it's honestly a pretty whatever bonus. Like, I don't know how many people are gonna, like, you know, be set with three crewmates and then want to go get a whole new round of crewmates that have these bonus skills, especially if they're elite crewmates, but they're also like way more expensive to acquire. I don't know how many people are going to be sold on that without the bonuses being much better than like your gunners do 50% more damage, which is a lot, but is not really too important, I think. In addition to that, Railjack is also getting Ergoglast. Ergoglast is the leader of the Perrin sequence, and he is going to be offering melee weapons as rewards for doing Railjack content. That's probably going to involve some sort of token or something that you're going to be getting from Railjack missions, and then that's how you're going to be getting some of the new weapons from the Railjack loop. I'm really hoping that what's going to happen here is that basically for all of the Corpus-style Railjack missions, we're going to get tokens in addition to whatever our regular rewards are, and then it'll work a lot like the Teshin shop, where there will be the normal, like, unique rewards like these melee weapons, but then also maybe, you know, Endo or Relics or some kind of evergreen reward that we can constantly go back to, that we can be more happy about doing the Railjack missions, as a lot of the Railjack missions are pretty underwhelming in terms of being rewarding as it stands right now. And we have another very, very weird thing, and that is that we have some new clan advertisement options entering the game. Basically, you're going to be able to go to Maru's Bazaar and pay her in resources or whatever in order to put your clan in front of people and make it so that it's known that you're recruiting for your clan. This was a really, really strange thing to see, as the clan system is there, but we haven't had, like, you know, clans getting together for events in quite a good long time. I mean, we built the Railjack launcher area, but it's not really a clans getting together thing. It's not really a big clan event or anything like that. So this kind of just came out of nowhere. Whenever they started showing this off, my immediate first thought was, why? And then my second immediate thought was, I really wish this was an auction house instead, to, like, you know, prop up trading and make trading more of an easily accessible thing to more players, because I think that is honestly a lot more of like an upfront issue that, you know, seems similar in scope to what we're getting out of the advertised clan and clan kind of browser stuff that they seem to be adding. But it's an improvement, I think, to clans and stuff, so it's not bad, but it just seems like a thing that I don't know why, right? I don't really know what the impetus for this system is. I'm not unhappy with it. It honestly seems high quality. It's just a really, really strange addition to the game. And then after that, we have just a couple bits and pieces of information. We have the modular arc wing, and that was met with it's almost done, eventually it'll be done. And then I just, you know, tacked 3 question marks onto this because we kind of stopped hearing about it. It'll happen. Also the ghoul saw someday will occur. Very, very weird talk around that. And then we have a tentative melee and gun review. There's going to be a dev workshop around June 16th, which is very important. Obviously expect videos from me talking about whatever they talk about in the workshop. And we have some pretty rough stuff here in terms of notes. We can expect nerfs and expect a power increase for guns from mods and upgrades. And they're going to address the arsenal divide in Steel Path. So the expect nerfs thing here is the really weird part. And then also the way that they're going to go about making guns more powerful. So they're going to go about making guns more powerful by just like raw power creeping the mods that we already use on our guns as it stands right now, right? That's literally what this says, is that you can expect a power increase for guns via mods and new upgrades. With that, that basically just means that a bunch of the mods that we use now are just suddenly going to enter the vast expanse of mods that are completely useless on our primary and secondary weapons. Like, we have mods right now that are adding like 30% puncture, and no one uses them because they're garbage. So we're just gonna get a bunch of mods that are sometimes used, let's say like heavy caliber, perhaps, where they're just gonna be outclassed, and now no one will use that mod anymore because it's not worth using over these new ones. Like, that's what it really sounds like we're getting in terms of bringing weapons up, which is not exactly a satisfying thing to hear. And then in addition to that, expecting a handful of nerfs, which would be expected to be on melee weapons, is very, very strange, because, like, why is kind of the question, right? Like, we know melee weapons are good and are generally in, like, a vastly good space. Like, you can use most melee weapons and honestly be pretty happy with their output. Like, I've got a video coming out tomorrow on, like, the Volnus and stuff, and in the scope of melee weapons, the Volnus is not particularly impressive, but I'm not going to tell someone that they chose a bad weapon if you chose the Volnus Prime. Like, that weapon, it totally works, and it's good, and if you like it, use it in content. It's gonna get you through that content. And I think that's a good place for melee weapons to be, where we're kind of in a state where you can use what you want outside of the most possible, like, the trashiest of trash items. Like, I mean, you can get away with using the plasma sword, but it might be a crime that you're getting away with using the plasma sword in really high-level content. But that's kind of a good thing, to be able to use all the weapons and not have anything be basically ineffective in the game. So it's really weird that we're getting any nerfs at all instead of just bringing our primaries and secondary weapons, and not even all our secondary weapons, because obviously the Kuva Nucor exists, but just bringing a lot of the secondaries up and just getting everything kind of on the same level, because I feel like the level of melee weapons is pretty solid right now. But whatever. Moving on from that, we do have another kind of side small update, which is going to be the Wave Rider mini quest. This is going to be a Vent Kid quest, and honestly, probably the most interesting thing here is that there are going to be new Parazon mods, because Parazon mods are potentially very interesting. Everyone has access to the Parazon. There might be some cool things for the Parazon to do. I personally think that the Parazon needs to be more well integrated into the main loop of the game, because it should be much more important than it is, and probably function more like a Doom glory kill than kind of the just do stuff with liches stabber, and do stuff against bosses stabber. But new mods potentially could make that happen, honestly, so we'll see how that goes, and that might, you know, change some major things in terms of what we can expect out of the Parazon. In addition to that, we're getting 2 new game modes, and I say new kind of in quotes here, because it is Corpus Railjack plus Survivals and Corpus Railjack plus Spies. I don't really like personally the like do Railjack and then don't do Railjack for a while and then leave on Railjack, because it really feels tacked on to what survival is as a game mode and even what spy is as a game mode. And I don't think it really capitalizes very much on what Railjack is honestly very good at right now. So I'm not particularly excited for that stuff, but perhaps they will have good rewards. Spy as a mission type is very rewarding, and there's always the potential that the rotations on survival are very good. So they might be able to give us good incentives for going and doing those missions and tacking on the extra bit of Railjack to them. So that's the thing. In addition to that, we have some new weapons and ephemera coming with this, and Harrow's alternate helmet. So ostensibly this will be a nice bonus thing here. And because Yureli is related to K-Drives, there's speculation but not confirmation that she would be linked to the Vent Kids in some way, which is interesting. She's also a Warframe that they've said explicitly is supposed to be like a kind of like younger Warframe or whatever, and the Vent Kids are the Vent Kids after all. So I think there's weight to the idea that Yureli will be related to this Wave Rider stuff, especially because it's the Wave Rider and she's the water riding Warframe. But it's not confirmed yet, so take that stuff with a grain of salt. She could come from basically anywhere. In addition to that, we have, like I said, Dog Days returns on June 7th, and that is going to come with the Soaktron skin. So if you wanted the Soaktron and you wanted to be able to put that on a bunch of weapons, that's going to be a thing that you're going to be able to do. And then besides that, we have a very important note actually right here at the bottom of this section of notes, which is that Nightwave, they're finally doing it. They are going to not do big, extensive, story-based Nightwaves anymore. They're going to try and like break that system down into more of what, say, Sorties are right now, it sounds like, and kind of make that hopefully like a long-term repeating system where players can be constantly rewarded for their efforts into the Nightwave. And then maybe on the possible bright side speculation on my part, maybe we would get one or two items new per Nightwave that are just like little cosmetic pieces that we can earn at the end of each season. I personally think that would be really nice. I think that would be, you know, very achievable for DE to do. And I think that having a Nightwave that occurs, say, you know, starts and then ends every 2 months, I think that would be really, really solid for like constantly having a good reason to log in each week and like get these challenges done and get the good rewards that come out of it on a much more regular basis, which is what Nightwave is supposed to be in general, as opposed to these like much longer, extremely protracted experiences that we've been having recently, where a Nightwave lasts like 9 months or whatever. And by month four, you really couldn't possibly care less and you're just waiting for it to end because you're already at level like 65 out of 30 levels. So yeah, it's nice. I think that like Nightwave obviously being broken down and like becoming more simple sounds like a bad thing, but I think in the end it will probably actually be an overall huge positive for the game at large. And personally, I thought that they were going to get to four like big unique Nightwaves, but only got to three. That's all right though. We pretty much knew, if you've been around long enough, that these big upkeep systems that require these big rotating rewards super don't last in Warframe, because it always just ends up that they are trying to do something else that's different and it requires their attention, and these systems always break down just like Sorties did. So there's that. Now moving on, let's talk about Yureli. So with Yureli, we have a few things to talk about here. And that is all of her abilities and then my overall general impression with her. And I'll have some video here playing of what her abilities kind of look like. And it's worth noting that I think her ability effects and stuff are pretty clearly unfinished here. So I wouldn't take that to be like what the end release is going to be whenever we get the visuals all done and everything. So we're just talking about kind of the statistical effects and stuff of everything that we see. But first of all, she does have a signature sidearm, which is kind of a bubble beam gun is what we know about it. Looks cool. It seems like a neat little thing, and she's going to be using secondaries a lot because of her passive, which is while she is moving, her critical stats go up. So, of course, you want to be moving and you want to be shooting with your secondary. Seems good. With that, we have her 1, 2, 3, and 4. So her 1 is Sea Snares, which are little globes that she can throw out that will grab and ensnare enemies and deal damage to them over time. This ability seems like pretty throwaway and doesn't do much for her kit overall, in my opinion. And then her 2, which is Marilina. Marilina is her K-Drive ability, and it is literally a K-Drive. You ride on it, and it's a K-Drive. The addition to that is that you get damage reduction while riding it, and it has health. So basically, it'll work kind of like Neja's shield, where you'll still take a little bit of damage through it, but you'll be transmuting that damage into your K-Drive, and eventually your K-Drive will die, and you will, you know, ostensibly fall off of it and have to recast Marilena. So this is going to be your survivability stuff here, and I really think that this ability is going to have a lot of immediate troubles because of collision with just all of like this cluttered stuff that's in any given tile set that you're going to be trying to ride it through. Because even on the tile set where we were getting this shown off, which is one of the most open, big, like area tile sets in the game, Reb was clearly having trouble navigating just the little objects that are just everywhere and blocking your path because it's the K-Drive controls and the K-Drive bouncing off everything. I really wish there had been some addition to this to implement maybe that like you could surf through things that have soft line of sight, so that you'd be able to go through all these tiny obstacles and really like blaze through a level very quickly, especially if it's like a really cluttered level. Then maybe Yureli would have an advantage where, you know, she's water or whatever, and she can just slide right through these things and not have any trouble with it. I think something like that probably would be pretty necessary in order for this to feel not clunky in, you know, like the Grineer Galleon or some such other different, you know, much tighter tile set that we're usually going to be in. And then her three is the Aqua Blades. So these are basically just, you know, spinning blades around Yureli. This is what we saw in her concept art that I thought were glaives, and I thought it would be really cool if they were, you know, exalted glaives that she could throw out and make explode and do all this other stuff, but they just spin in a circle around her, and we don't know what this is going to look like when modded. There's the definite possibility that you add range and it adds a bunch of glaives that go out much further and hit like this huge area, and it's a very good ability. But from what it looks like your basic plan is to ride on Marilena, activate the spinning blades, and like just ride through enemies and have the blades kill them as you're riding through, which is like a reasonable enough plan. And maybe when it's actually like full release, it'll be a big enough area and there might be some way that the K-Drive is not clunkily going through these tile sets. But it looked like kind of rough conceptually, especially because it didn't seem like the Aqua Blades had any vertical range. So whenever you would need to jump with the K-Drive, you're just suddenly kind of not doing anything but jumping, and your Aqua Blades aren't killing anything, which is pretty rough. And then finally, we have Cyclone Strike, and Cyclone Strike is maybe the most mysterious of any of her abilities in that you use your four, and it's this big, long animation that ends up with enemies being pulled into a cyclone, and then it dealing damage to them, and it throwing them up into the air. And my immediate impression of this ability is that this is just all of the bad parts that they just took out of Zephyr's four. Like, Zephyr's four is incredible right now after being fixed with her rework. And this is just all of the bad things that Zephyr's 4 used to do, which was pull enemies together and then throw them up into the air where you can't hit them easily. That used to be like the modus operandi for Zephyr's 4th ability, and they fixed that so that her ability is good, and now this ability just has all those exact same problems, just like retreading the past hardcore. I really wasn't expecting that stuff to be reincarnated as Cyclone Strike, and I think it'll just be as bad as it was on Zephyr whenever that was what her ability did. It doesn't really seem to synergize with anything that Yureli is doing, because as I said, without the verticality of the Aqua Blades, throwing the enemies up into the air doesn't really help the Aqua Blades hit them or anything like that. And while you could theoretically cast Cyclone Strike maybe right where you're standing and pull enemies into the blades, if they're falling over and like you're on your K-Drive, they're probably not going to be hit by that because they're going to be too low as they get pulled into the Cyclone Strike. So it's a very, very weird thing. I had a bit of brainstorming whenever we were watching or post-watching the dev stream that I might just throw up on the channel for you guys to check out, which are some ideas I had on like how these abilities could be basically the same but different and really support more of what it seems like her playstyle wants to be. But of course, there's always, you know, changes that can happen before release, and she could be very different from what we saw. It seemed like they basically just got Yureli working as of this dev stream. So hopefully some changes and, you know, revisions come in and make her better. And honestly, recently D has had a really, really good track record of, if a Warframe release is in a pretty lackluster state, like say Zaku or even Protea, who, for those who don't remember, did release in a pretty lackluster state, both of them have been fixed at this point. Protea is absolutely incredible right now. Like, honestly, one of my favorite Warframes, period, like overarching between all of them. And Zaku got fixed up to the point where they might be a little bit of like a high investment in terms of like the amount of like, you know, focus that you might need to play them and upkeep on like their different timers and stuff. But they're good. Like, they can do a lot of different content. They have their niche with their box breaking and stuff. And it's good stuff. So I think even if Yureli launches and is in maybe kind of a more poor state, there's a lot of room for her kit to like become good, even with a lot of number changes and stuff. I think that they could get to that point if it does turn out to release in like a little bit of a lackluster way. So yeah, it's interesting. I'm looking forward to it. She has some like pretty cool visual design to her. I think that she colored really well based on what they showed on stream, and the visual design is like killer on her, and I think that, you know, the abilities have potential, maybe with some like slight messing around, or if the numbers are much better than they seem to be from just watching their previews. Obviously, none of the numbers were final whenever we were watching this on stream. So yeah, that is going to kind of do it for the dev stream breakdown. Hopefully you guys have enjoyed this video, and I will see y'all tomorrow for the Astela Prime and Volnus Prime video. Hopefully you guys enjoyed that as well. Goodbye, everybody.